Others are still on vacation. Others texted me that they're still with their families. But this afternoon, now that we're here, we're going to praise and sing worship to the Lord. And I saw the new sign here behind me. It's called, in English, Be the Salt and Light of the World.
Yes, it is. Yes,
wow, exactly. That's nice. And in this world full of darkness, we must be the light and salt of this world. All right, as we sing, let's all stand up. We're going to be singing praises to the Lord. And we have a new singer here. She's Samantha. So we will be enjoying singing today.
Glory instead.
18-19, it says, "Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and streams in the desert."
I'm
let go of the things from behind and go towards what God has in store for us ahead. It says, forgetting these things which are behind and reaching forth unto those which are before, I press on towards the mark to win the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. This new year, let's search and strive for what it is that God has in store for us.
Forever. Daejeon for this afternoon.
Let's pray. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Almighty Father, we thank you graciously for New Year 2022. Lord, as we begin this blessed year with a renewed hope in you, we ask you to bless our OEM. Lord, thank you very much for all things you have done for our OEM up to now. Your touch on our lives has been far more abundant than we have asked for. Thank you so much for your presence. As we start the new year, we reflect on the past year. We truly depend on anything that prevents us from dwelling in you. Forgive us for the promises you made, but we made but failed to keep. In this year, may we bring you great glory. Let us not seek glory in vain, but praise you, exalt you, and glorify you. In the new year, make us more humble and humble, so that we may live a life that loves our neighbors, serves you, and glorifies you. Lord, please heal the sick among us, deliver those in tribulation, and guide the future of our children. Today, our pastor Brian will preach about God and us. Father, please bless our pastor to speak the words that were moved by the Holy Spirit. As he delivers your message to us, then your spirit comes to him, come to him and teach us through him. Father, I pray again for pastor. Although he is busy, please take care of his family and all his affairs so that he can do well in the ministry of the church. We pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
May I request everyone to please stand up again as we're going to greet one another with a warm smile as we're going to sing, "We're Together Again."
We're together again, just praising the Lord.
Visitors and friends. Is there anybody here for the first time? Anybody here for the first time? Okay. Well, if you'd like to, you could stand up and tell us your name and where you're from, if you'd like. Okay.
We're the Smith family, and I've been in Daejeon for three and a half years.
Uh-huh. Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you very much for coming. Okay. Very good. All right. And yes. And as mentioned before, we have a new motto, salt and light of the world. That's for those of you who came late and didn't hear the earlier message. Thank you for that representative prayer of Song Ki Chang. Next week's representative prayer will be given by Marsha. Small group fellowship will be continued after the service. Saturday Bible study is on a break right now. It will resume Saturday, February 12th. OEM monthly vision meeting for January is going to be held after the service. All leaders are required to attend. Thank
you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Today's sermon is about Job again. So if former sermon was about God responding to Job's question, arguments, like asking why are you doing this to me, to the most innocent person, today's sermon is about Job's confession after he hear God's answer about his question. So if you see today's passage is Job chapter 42 verse 1 to 7. And if you see today's passage, you can see Job confessing who God is and who he is. And through today's passage, we can see the gap between human being and God, and then how God filled that gap between human and himself with his love. So for today, through looking at today's passage, I'm hoping for us to learn the relationship between God and us more deeply through looking at Job's confession today. Job chapter 42, verse 1 to 7. Let me read the scripture for you. Then Job replied to the Lord, "I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, 'Who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge?' Surely I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. You said, 'Listen now and I will speak. I will question you and you shall answer me.' My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes." After the Lord has said these things to Job, he said to Eliphaz the Temanite, "I am angry with you and your two friends because you have not spoken the truth about me as my servant Job has." The first insight that we can gain from today's passage is that God wants to be the one who speaks, and he wants us to be the listener. It does not mean that God does not want to listen to our prayer, or God does not want to hear our prayer. But the point of this passage, verse 4, is that he wants to be the one who speaks, and he wanted Job to be the listener. In other words, he wanted Job to be the Job to follow his commandment, the things, and he wanted Job to be the obey what he says. Let's look at verse 4 again. He says, "You said, 'Listen now, and I will speak. I will question you, and you shall answer me.'" He does not follow our plan or any other's plan, but he wants to be the leader. God wants to be the leader. He does not follow any other's plan, but he leads all things into his majestic plan. We give thanks to God whenever God answers our prayer, right? We give thanks to God. But we tend to think that God did not answer our prayer if the way God answers our prayer is different with how we prayed, or different with what we think. If the way God answers our prayer is different from our prayer, or if different from how we prayed, we don't count that as answered prayer. But church, unfortunately, God's plan and God's thought does not always line up with our plan and with our thinking. And the proof is written in the Bible. There are many stories in the Bible, and if you look at the stories, we can see God does not always answer his people's prayer as they prayed. So if you see the Bible, when Peter was in the prison, his disciples prayed for him to be released from the prison. So God answered their prayer and released Peter from the prison. When John the Baptist was in the prison, their disciples prayed for him to be released too. So God answered their prayer through using John by taking his life. And he was saying for David and Jonathan too. They both of them were sincere worshipper of God. They loved to worship God and they loved to glorify God through their life. God loved both of them and answered their prayer and made David king of Israel, but took Jonathan's life from the country where people don't even know the name. What Jesus Christ has done for us is same thing, same too. Actually, it is something that human cannot really understand. I mean, I watched a YouTube video about Pastor Yang, and he had one son, and his son was murdered by a murderer, but he adopted that murderer as his son. So when I read, after I watched the video, when I read the comments on that video, I could see many people many people said, Pastor Yang is really, really good believer. He is really good Christian. But at the same time, there were many comments saying that I cannot understand why he did that. Church, if I were God, the one who created all this world, and so the brokenness in this world, and so this world getting ruined by human sin, I think I would clean all up and then make new ones again, because that would be the fastest and easiest way. But what God did, the decision that he made was that would take way, way longer than that. He made the hardest decisions because he decided to reconcile every single thing that has been broken in this world. And the way he reconciled this world is it's very hard to understand, because in order to reconcile all things in this world, what he did was sacrificing his only son, Jesus Christ. God's plan is not always understandable to us. But indeed, every single decision that he makes is actually best for every one of us and every single creations that he made. So we should not pray with the mindset like, oh, God should answer my prayer like this. Or God should allow me to do this. God should give me this job. God should make me do this or something like that. Have you ever prayed and it seemed like God did not answer? I'm really sorry about that. I really do. But at the same time, I think it is very hopeful news, because at least it means that this word is led not by our thought, but only by God. Verse 2 also says that, like this, I know that you can do all things, no purpose of yours can be thwarted. So church, we should be open for God to use us for his plan. When God uses us, all the sufferings can become the driving force in your life. The sorrow will make you stronger to go through all the sufferings in your life. And even death can be a new beginning. Therefore, church, we should not limit God's majestic plan in our human boundaries, but we should trust and leave it up to him even when it doesn't line up with our own plan. The second insight that we can gain from today's passage is that we should know God not just by hearing, but also through seeing. Let's take a look at verse 5 again. Verse 5 says, my ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. It does not mean that Job literally saw God with his two eyes, but it means that Job encountered with God. Job experienced God. If someone asks us if we know God, we would say yes. But there are two kinds of knowing someone or knowing God. When I was in the Philippines as a missionary, I had a neighbor, Korean neighbor, who was a volleyball player here in Korea and retired and came to the Philippines and then running a business in the Philippines. And he had two sons. And one of the sons always asked me to teach him how to play guitar. Because at that time, like for these days, if you want to learn how to play guitar or other instruments, if you just search on YouTube, then there are many like guitar lesson videos or like drum lesson videos that you can watch when to taught guitar yourself, right? But at that time, there weren't those kind of sources that I could use to learn guitar. So in order to figure out something, in order to figure out like scales or some skills, I had to take really, really long time to figure out like those kind of things. So I did not just want to tell this to that kid just on the spot, just at once. So I always told him that like I don't want to teach you guitar. This is very valuable things. So I'm sorry, like I took a really long time to earn this, so I cannot just teach this to you. But later, when I was in the military service, I was laying down on my bed and then watching a TV show. It was an audition program, Superstar K. Have you ever, guys have heard about that program, Superstar K? It's like a Voice Got Talent or like American Got Talent, something like that. But that's a Korean version of those kind of programs. So I was watching Superstar K, and then that kid showed up in that program. And he was playing guitar and singing. And he was really, really good. So there were other my soldier friends, and I said, I know that guy. And then they said, I know that guy too. But what they meant was that they know him through hearing about him or hearing his music. Or hearing about him from like other like program or TV show or like news or something like that. His name is Kim Yeon-sung. But when I said I know this guy, it meant I know this guy through my personal experience, personal face-to-face experience. Then here is the question for us: do we know God? Do we know God? God doesn't want to be known as just one of the characters in the Bible, just one of God in this world, or only the divine being who's far beyond the universe. But he wants to be known as our Father, who can have intimate bond with us, who can talk with us, who can walk with us, who can spend time with us. If someone asks us if we know God, we would say yes. But is it because you have heard about Him, or is it because you really experienced Him in your life? God wants to have intimate bond with you. He doesn't want to be known just as one of the characters in the Bible or one of the gods that you have heard. I was a youth pastor when I was in the States, and one of the questions one of the topic kids like to argue was prayer. They always ask me, why do we have to pray? Bible says that God knows everything. God knows everything we need. He should know what we need, like even though I don't pray. They always argued me like that, like little kids. Like to, you know, kids like to argue, so they like to argue with those kind of topics. Then I said like this: we have to pray because God is not genie in the magic lamp. The difference between other religion and the Christianity is this: the other four other religions, they do pretty much the same thing with the Christianity. They worship their own God, they have praised Him, and they pray. And then they do good things. But the difference between Christianity and other religions is that other religions, they do those kind of things to earn something from their God. But Christianity, we do this because we already have earned. We do all those things as a response of God's grace. So I told, whenever kids like to argue with those kind of things, I told them like this: we have to pray because He's not our genie. Prayer we have to pray just like we have conversation with our physical daddy, physical father. As we pray, as we talk with our dad, and when we talk with our dad, that conversation is not only about asking what we need, right? We just talk regular things or things that happens in our life. When we talk about those kind of things with God, we call that prayer. Yes, we can ask what we need, but it is having communication with God, just like we have communication with our physical dad. And this is the third point that that we can gain from Job's confession. Verse 7 says like this. After the Lord had said these things to Job, he said to Eliphaz the Temanite, I'm angry with you and your two friends because you have not spoken the truth about me as my servant Job has. If you read the book of Job, the whole story tells that, I mean, that everything that Job said in the book of Job was pretty much about arguing God that why are you doing this to me? I'm an innocent person. God, if you are alive, please tell me, please reply to me. But everything that Job's friend said was pretty much about like, hey, Job, if you're suffering, there should be something wrong with you because God is most just God. How dare you say that to God? You cannot say that God is unfair because he is the most just God. But if you see verse 7, it says what Job said is actually right and what his friend said is wrong. But the point of this verse is not that we are allowed to argue with God. But the point of this verse is that we can lay down everything before God. We can lay down our thoughts, of honest feelings, and everything before God because he's our Heavenly Father. You can talk to him as you can, as you talk to your father. Church, this is the relationship God wants to, God wants with you. Yes, he is God, the creator of every creature in this world. But at the same time, he is your father. He wants us to talk to us, to talk to him just like we talk to our Heavenly Fathers. And he wants us to know him, not only through the knowledge that we get from books or teachers, but through directly experiencing him. Yes, we should fear God and be in awe of God, yes. However, fearing and being in awe of him does not mean that we have to lock his existence only in a certain frame called divine being. Church, I know it is hard to take this like two images of God that seemingly contradict each other, because we like to talk about black and white kind of things. So like, if this is right, this is wrong. If this is right, this is wrong. We like to discern something clearly. But if you read the Bible, there are many things that seemingly contradict each other, such like kingdom of God is here already, but not yet. Or the triune God. God is the Father, but at the same time, he is the Son. And what God realized, what Job realized was same thing. He realized that God is the creator God, almighty God, who's way wiser, way greater, way smarter than us. And he created all these things, and everything in this world is under his sovereignty. But at the same time, he realized that God, who's the most powerful, is his Father. It is not like sometimes God is divine being, and sometimes he is something else. It's just like my students call me teacher, and my son call me dad. But it means that he is both God and Father in every moment in our life. So church, our God is sovereign, all-powerful, and all-knowing. He is worthy and demands our absolute praise and obedience. Yet, at the same time, He is also a loving Father who cares so much for us that He was willing to give up His one and only Son to pay for our sins and restore our relationship with Him. So, church, this would be something that we have to remind ourselves. We have to be aware as we start this year. The relationship between God and us is more than just divine, one of the divine being and humankind. The greatest God, the greatest God, and most powerful God is our Father. And I'm encouraging you to live through this year, 2022, through awareing of this fact. Let's pray. Almighty God, our Father, from the fullness of our soul, we adore you. We are deeply grateful that you have adopted us as your sons and daughters, and that you ever hold us in your loving embrace. Teach us to love you deeply with all our soul. Father God, we long to be united to you and love you. Have the Holy Spirit touch our heart to let us love you as you always loved us. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Your glory and majesty, and the great gift of your Son Jesus, and of the Holy Spirit which guides us daily. All we have is yours, and we ask that you would use us and all we have as you will. We also ask that these offerings be used to spread the gospel and for the growth of your kingdom on earth and in heaven. Amen.
Let's close today's service with Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who
who trespasses us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory.